At a time when there is an unprecedented crackdown on black money in the country, when there is a thrust on making the common man's source of income transparent and ensuring a corruption-free society, why shouldn't the same apply to political parties? Shouldn't their source of funding also come under scrutiny? Shouldn't political parties now agree to come under the ambit of the RTI? That's what we're debating here on The Blueprint tonight. And joining us on the debate, Dr. Shambit Patra, national spokesperson of the BJP, Sunit Chopra, leader of the CPIM, and All India Joint Secretary of All India Agricultural Workers Union, and Professor Jagdeep Chokar, founder, Association for Democratic Reforms. Good evening, gentlemen. Dr. Shambit Patra, I'd like to start with you, because at a time when the government is ushering the entire country into an era of transparency, there is a crackdown on corruption, a crackdown on black money, why is there a reluctance from political parties to make their source of funding, their expenditure entirely transparent? Why is there still a reluctance for political parties to come under the ambit of the RTI?
I would answer that specifically, but to begin with, as you rightly pointed out, there's an unprecedented attack on the generation and use of black money. And definitely this attack has also, in a way, attempted to bring out to the fore the political funding as well. And the political funding, which was as yet quite untransparent, also has been brought to the forefront, and political parties are also hit. Because transparency would increase, black money was also used for political funding, which would be hit by this demonetization process. Now, as far as the issues, the specifics of the RTI Act is concerned, since the interpretation of 2H, if you would remember the section 2H of the RTI Act,
yes,
that is what is of prime importance. Mm-hmm. As far as Bharatiya Janata Party is concerned, we are for transparency, but the 2H which mentions, section 2H which mentions that political parties are public authorities, naturally that is the reason as to why there has been some amount of debate and discussion around this section 2H, because if political parties are made into public authorities, leave aside the financial part, I would speak about the financial part also. But the most important issue is people would be asking question on what transpired in the general secretary's meeting within the party domain, what happened to the particular seat as to how the decision was made that a particular person should be given the ticket for contesting in that election. These are the issues which have to be settled. If you would remember, in 2013 September, this whole issue was referred to a parliamentary standing committee as well, and the parliamentary standing committee has given its report, had then given its report. The whole thing went to the Supreme Court also. Since the whole thing is under the discussion and the umbrella of Supreme Court, it would not be very fair for a national spokesperson to make further comments on it. I would just say that look, as far as the financial transparency is concerned, Representation of People's Act 1951, the RPA 1951, and the Income Tax Act, these two are the important acts under which the financial proceedings of a political party can be put into the public domain. Even the Election Commission, if I'm right, under the section of 29C, can make all the financial proceedings of any political party public, and that the Election Commission has been doing. As far as the financial section is concerned, Patra, this is all that I have to submit.
Shambit, there are two issues here. There are two issues here. Yeah, you know, you mentioned 2013, and I must remind you that in 2013, the BJP did say that we are for anything which moves towards transparency, and yet now we see that as far as the RTI is concerned, you are with all other political parties in trying to say that we should not come under the ambit. Last year, the government opposing a plea in the Supreme Court to bring political parties under the RTI Act said that this would adversely impact the internal working and political functioning. I understand that's what you've alluded to right now, when you said that then, you know, there would be questions asked as to what was discussed in the meeting and questions asked about minutiae which are not important. But that's not the point. The question that the nation would really want to ask, the people would want to ask, is about the funding. And there are two issues here. I'd like to bring Professor Jagdeep Chokar in on this, because Professor Chokar, there are two issues here. One is of the funding itself, and how much do we really know about what is the source of funding? As per the ADR's data, how much do we know about the political party's funding? How much of it comes from cash? How much of it comes from donors that are listed? What information is available? And the other issue is of electoral expenditure, and I'll come to that later. But first, Professor Chokar, why this reluctance to be transparent as to where this funding comes from?
It has just been said that political parties provide all details of funding under Representation of People Act 1951 and the Section 29C of the Representation of People Act and the Income Tax Act. Let me now clarify, under the Income Tax Act, every political party files an income tax return every year in which they declare their total income. Obviously, they pay no tax on the total income because Section 13A of the Income Tax Act exempts 100% of the income of a political party from income tax. But there is a proviso. The proviso says, provided the party gives a statement of donations of more than rupees 20,000 each to the Election Commission of India under Section 29C of the Representation of People Act. Now, when we got copies of income tax returns of political parties after battling political parties for 2 years in the CIC, Central Information Commission, we discovered that political parties have declared anywhere from 500 crores to 1,000 crores of income on which they legally do not pay any tax. But when we went to the Election Commission, we to get a copy of the donations of more than 20,000 rupees each, we discovered that on an average, taking of all political parties, the donations of more than 20,000 rupees explain about 20 to 25% of the annual income of the political parties. The 75 to 80% of the income of political parties on an average, the number varies from party to party, but on an average it is that number, comes from sources which are not known. So when we went to political parties with RTI applications to ask for sources of unknown sources of this unknown income, they said they were not under the RTI Act. We went to the Central Information Commission. They said provide data to prove this. So we spent 2 years filing over 2,000 RTI applications to various government departments, got information from government departments, and as it was just said that Section 2H of the RTI Act is extremely important, the Central Information Commission, which is the highest statutory authority in the land to decide which body falls and is a public authority or not, after looking at all that data, the CIC found that 6 national political parties satisfied all the conditions laid down under Section 2H. And therefore, on the 3rd of June 2013, the Central Information Commission, in a full bench decision, said that these 6 national political parties are under our public authorities under the RTI. Now, the question is,
Professor Chopra,
it is not left to any body to agree.
This is the most important point. I'm coming back to you, but I just want to quickly bring in Suneet Chopra on what you mentioned earlier. Now, if this is the fact and if this is what has been thrown up by the research done, that 70 to 75% of the party's funds are in fact from unknown sources, the source of income is unknown, then isn't it a legit question for people to ask? People want to know, where does this money come from? Don't you think this applies to political parties too, Suneet Chopra? People want to know the rallies which cost crores and crores of rupees, campaigning, travel, stay. How does anyone know how any of this is funded?
You see, there are ways of finding out. We find, for example, my party, the CPIM, every year we put our returns on the website and anyone can go and have a look at them. And more than that, we give a proper account to the income tax authorities done by a chartered accountant. The third thing is that we are a party that does not accept donations from corporates. The third thing is that the Election Commission is given details entirely about our elections. It is true, you can say that many people say that a good bit is not known, but these are often very small donations for parties like ours. The
no, but Sunil Chopra, the point that Professor Chokar was making just now. No, you've said that you've talked about the fact that the income tax details are all listed. You put it up on your website. But what Professor Chokar was saying,
they're all there. They're on a website. Professor Chokar can look at them.
Yes, but what Professor Chokar is saying, he's looked at them, and that's
can ask
what he said. If you look into
why
them
not?
And you
nobody
look at the accounting of donations,
and we
more
do
than
not take
000,
money from corporates, which many parties do.
Fine, Mr.
We
Mr.
do not
Chopra,
take money
Professor
from
Chokar,
corporate.
If you want to come in here, the point that he was making is that the donations of more than 20,000 each amount to only 20 to 25% in most cases on average of the income shown by political parties. Where is the rest coming from? That is the question, Professor Chokar.
No, that is the question that we are seeking answers to. And let me complete the story. The CIC said that the six national political parties are public authorities under the Act. They refused to acknowledge the decision. They refused to implement this decision. They did not question the decision in any court of law. After 2 years, the CIC, after sending show cause notices, said we cannot get our decision implemented. Political parties are not responding to us. Does it mean that the statutory authority under RTI Act has no jurisdiction over political parties? And then we go to the Supreme Court,
Shobhit Patra,
and the Union of India says, not any political parties. The Union of India says political parties should not be under RTI. This is amazing. And there is if I may say, there seems to be a misunderstanding or misinterpretation of the RTI Act. All the information that was being said, that who will contest election, why are tickets being given, RTI Act has a section called Section 8, which has reasons under which information can be denied. Thousands and tens of thousands of public authorities in the country over the last 11 years have been denying information under those sections. Political parties are welcome to deny information that they don't want to give. But
okay.
Under the garb
Professor
of
Chokar, I will come to you on that point. We'll look at that in detail in just a minute. But the important point that you mentioned, Dr. Shobhit Patra, coming to you on that. Now, he was talking about the CIC judgment, and in its judgment, the CIC had said political parties should be held accountable under the RTI Act since their constitution was akin to setting up a body by the government, and they also perform public functions after availing various financial concessions by the center, and so on and so forth. Now, the fact is, why did you not go to the High Court? Did six major national political parties, as Professor Chokar just said, not get show cause notices from the CIC vis-a-vis this issue?
See, Tina, as far as the legal aspect is concerned, I in the very outset said that the whole thing is on the floor of the Supreme Court and the judgment is yet awaited. So legally the things are proceeding.
Exactly.
It would not be very apt on my part to take a legal angle right now because it is still being heard. Secondly, Professor Chokar's concerns are absolutely well founded because naturally he is a citizen, he's a responsible citizen, and he has every right to question all the political parties. Our only difference is, the Bharatiya Janata Party's only point of reference over here is, there are two aspects to this whole big debate. One aspect is the financial aspect, the transparency of the financial aspect, which should be genuine, and which I agree with Professor Chokar, we have to be explicitly transparent because this is a new era of transparency. And I can assure Professor Chokar and the nation through him that the intention of Prime Minister Mr. Narendra Modi and the intention of Amit Bhai Shah, the President of Bharatiya Janata Party,
the reluctance?
Has become extremely clear now. A new era of reforms has started.
Shobhit Patra, then why
sure
the reluctance?
I'm coming
why,
to that.
Why the,
I'm coming
why
to
the
that.
Reluctance
I'll answer
then?
That.
Yeah.
I'm answering that. I'll answer you satisfactorily. So in fact, the reforms have started, this whole demonetization, or rather the cessation of the legal currency, in fact, is a step towards it, which even the country is acknowledging. Now, as far as the second part, not the financial part, the second part is concerned, the hurdles. I'll just get you into a case study, and Professor Choker can correct me if I'm wrong. He said that, well, there is a Section 8 under which we can even negate that these certain informations need not be given. But even to attend to the Section 8, we need a whole paraphernalia. Any political party, a political party of the stature of Bharatiya Janata Party, which is almost the largest political party of the country, would need a huge paraphernalia. Almost 100 people working round the clock would be able to answer the questions that are being sent to us through this public authority, the Section 2H issue. Naturally, these are issues that have to be addressed. We are for transparency, and I can promise you all the required steps definitely in the future would be taken to see to it that the electoral reforms are in position and people of this country can know who donates how much to any political party.
And now, Shambhit, you mentioned the point of, you know, it's just logistically too difficult to answer every question that comes your way. That's really, you know, that's a fallacious argument, because the point is, A, if there are, there's some kind of malified intent with the, you know, I understand your fear. The fear is that political rivals might file RTI applications with malicious intent, and I'll come to Professor Choker on that. But it would also then be, A, a level playing field. And secondly, there are provisions, like he just mentioned, to ensure that this does not degenerate into an absolute free for all. Professor Choker.
You see, this is very interesting. The arguments that are being given now, they were given in the hearings in the CIC. They were, when the CIC sent show cause notices over 2 years, these arguments were not put forth to the CIC. The show cause notices were merely ignored. In the Supreme Court, the government of India gives an affidavit, and now it is being said that the matter is under on the floor of the Supreme Court. The question is, why did political parties not respond to the CIC is not under legal discussion. It is a fact which has happened. And the question you asked is, why did the 6 political parties did not respond to the show cause notices of the Supreme Court, of the CIC? That is not a legal issue. This is a matter of fact. And each party representative should be able to tell us, why did they not respond to show cause notices? The question is clearly being evaded.
Now, also, Professor Choker, before I just, you know, get closing comments from Sunit Chopra and Dr. Shambhit Patra, they talked about election expenditure, which is detailed to the Election Commission. Each candidate, in fact, files a detailed affidavit with regards to what the expenditure was. But we understand there is a dichotomy there, too, because most, in fact, show that they are well short of the limit that has been set. Yet, on the other hand, there is a perpetual demand that the election expenditure should, in fact, be increased. What have you found in your research?
You see, this is again the election expenditure affidavits that the candidates are required to give at the end of the election. In 2009 Lok Sabha election, we analyzed the election expenditure affidavits of 6,753 candidates. Out of those, only 4 candidates said that they had exceeded the limit of expenditure. 30 candidates said that they had spent about 90 to 95% of the limit of the expenditure. So 6,753 minus 34 is 6,719. Now they said that they had spent only 45 to 55% of the limit. This is the data which is from sworn affidavits of the 6,700 candidates. On the other hand, we keep hearing a clamor that the limit is too low, it should be increased. And then, if I may add a sad note, just a few months before the 2014 election, one person who is unfortunately no more, may God rest his soul in peace, said in a public meeting in Mumbai that he had spent 8 crores on his 2009 Lok Sabha election. Now, obviously, there is mass scale lying going on in sworn election expenditures. And then we are told to believe that all expenditure, all details of expenditure are given to the election commission.
Professor Chokar, which is why people ask these questions, because people are aware of this. People are aware of exactly how much money is spent in electoral expenditure. People know what happens in Vidhan Sabha elections. People know what happened in Lok Sabha elections. People know the kind of money that is spent, which is why the questions are asked as to where this money comes from. And it's a very legit question that the people would ask. I'm running out of time here, but I thank you all very much for joining on us on this debate on the blueprint. We are in fact taking
this point
forward.
But there's one thing that you should add to.
At 10.
There's one thing you should see. Corporate funds should not be permitted, and the government should pay for elections.
Well, that, you know, that in itself is a separate debate, but thank you for that point, Sunit Chopra. I thank you and Dr. Shombit Patra and Professor Chokar for joining us on Blueprint this evening.